then we can assemble. But otherwise, have a nice day. Let's celebrate and enjoy the rest of the proceeding. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen of the press, I alluded to the reason why we're here earlier, but if you can allow us for 1 minute, we believe we have told the story in a couple of visual and audio aspects. So allow me to draw your attention to the screen.
Since 1946, Uganda Breweries has passionately brought Ugandans together in the wonderful spirit of progress and celebration. A shared masterpiece of domestic heritage produced by the soil sustained in a better tomorrow. From creating the first taste truly cherished by Uganda to changing with the times and bringing back many firsts. From giving nature millions of reasons to smile to being there for a million joyful moments that we've all shared. From championing the spirit of women, we invite you to take the front row seat in our story. 75 years in the making. A journey that without you would have never been worth undertaking. Journey of excellence and innovation, not created by any one individual, but a journey brought by Uganda.
Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, viewers across Uganda, my name is Juliana Kagwa. I'm Director of Corporate Relations at Uganda Breweries Limited, the company that we are celebrating today. So we've been talking about this celebration for about 6 months plus, and you must be wondering by now, why are we harping on about it? Why have we chosen this moment in time to stop and share? And it's simply because we believe we owe it to every single player in our value chain to not only celebrate, but to unpack what the formula for success is. In his book, Built to Last, Successful Habits of Visionary Companies, Jim Collins, and I think Jerry Perez, they talk about the how rather than the what. It is one thing to deliver outstanding or commendable results year on year. No secret that we had a relatively good year last year, but how did we go about it? And today we've put together a panel of leaders, past, present, and future, who will start to unpack for you what the formula for this success is about, what the how is, how in this year of 2020-21, where we've all undergone, whether it is heartache, whether it is loss of jobs, how we have withstood the test of time. We made a very healthy profit, which I keep going on about, a very healthy top line. But what did we do with those earnings? We spent them on our people, we spent them on our brands, and who better to tell you that story than the people at the helm of the organization? Today, we will be hosted by none other than our non-executive director, Mr. Jimmy D. Mugerwa, who has been so gracious as to moderate this conversation for us. And we've put together a panel of powerful, influential females, males across East Africa, not just Uganda, to start to unpack this journey for us. We hope that by the end of today, you will understand what is the role of Uganda Breweries Limited, what is the role of our industry in our social economic progress, and what indeed the next 75 years means for Uganda Breweries people. So without further ado, allow me to introduce Mr. Jimmy D. Mugerwa. Welcome, Jimmy. Jimmy is our non-executive director on the board of Uganda Breweries Limited. He is also the chairman of the DFCU board, And he's not a stranger to any of us, really, because he has been part and parcel and led from the forefront the oil and gas sector development in this country. Once again, thank you, Jimmy, for making the time. And without further ado, allow me to hand over to you to invite our panelists. Thank you, Jimmy.
Thank you, Juliana. Ladies and gentlemen, welcome to the deep dive sessions and journey. What we intend to do this morning is to share with you how we have arrived at this 75th anniversary. Our journey as UBL is very intertwined with the journey of Uganda. We've gone through the troughs and the ups, and we are now talking about the ups. And the opportunity for us is to share with you how, as leaders, we've managed to achieve the victory that we have achieved. I should say that these achievements are attributed to masterful leaderships that we've had all the way from the board down to management. And allow me at this juncture to mention just a few of our board chairs. We had Dr. Martin Alike, who was a board chair for Uganda Breweries. We had Dr. Alan Shinobi, who was also board chair. We have Dr. William Kalema, who was also a board chair, and also our current chair, who is Japheth Kato. And from UBL, we've had a lot of managing directors who, during each of their tenures, brought their own unique crafts, almost like we do with the beers. And we also had very successful marketing directors. And this morning, we're going to get a chance to see how and what they did. UBL has played a significant role in the development of Uganda in various ways over the last 75 years. But we don't believe that all the stakeholders, be it government or all the communities, or even the media and other general public, recognize just how significant this is. We have grown from strength to strength. And there are very few companies in Uganda that had had a history of 75 years. So I want to take this opportunity to just mention the numbers and put you a bit in context, to put things in context for you. As an example, Uganda Breweries, for the last 75 years, has paid over 7.4 trillion shillings in taxes. Last year alone, we paid to Uganda Revenue Authority 420 billion shillings. There are very few companies in Uganda who can boast of that. Not only have we paid taxes, but we've also made social investments in communities. Every year, for example, we spend 4 billion shillings in the Water for Life program, allowing over 2 million people to access water. Uganda Breweries has led an initiative where we have planted 4.7 million trees. We are not only about celebrating life, but we're also about sustainability, and you'll hear about that. We have supported agriculture, and you know agriculture is a mainstay for Uganda. And through our local raw materials, we have 32,000 farmers, and we have used over 600,000 tons in our production processes. And not only are we talking about agriculture, social investments, and taxes, but we're also talking about diversity. We're talking about diversity in scholarships. We pay $1 billion annually in scholarships to the disadvantaged Ugandans for them to go to school. We care about women, and women empowerment is big, as you'll see from the panel, and you'll hear from our group MD. We are probably the only company in this country that gives a 6 months maternity leave to our ladies when they go to work, when they go to give birth, so that they can still earn even as they are nursing their babies for 6 months. And coming to the beer, that beautiful beer that we talk about, we've brewed about 1.5 billion hectoliters of beer. So celebrating lives, growing Ugandans, taps into the core aspects of what we're talking about here. And allow me, ladies and gentlemen, to introduce our leaders, the people who have been at the helm of leading this organization. We have collected past managing directors, we've got a marketing director, and we've got current leaders for the organization. So let me start by introducing our group managing director, Madam Jen Karuku. Jen, welcome to Uganda. Jen comes all the way from Nairobi. She's also a fellow board member at East African Breweries. But the interesting thing about it, Jen, also, she's been the chairman of the task force, the COVID-19 task force in Kenya. She's the chairman of Vision 2030 in Kenya. So she's a lady with a lot of accolades. Jen, welcome. The next person I would like to introduce is Alvin Bugwa. Alvin is our own son here. He's been our managing director. And just recently, this month, Alvin has been promoted to go and head a region, the Latin American and Caribbean area. He'll tell us more about that. Welcome, Alvin. And allow me to introduce a colleague in oil and gas, but who also worked at the brewery as a marketing director, Madame Marion Muyobo. And Marion, as those of you know her vibes, will, if there's an opportunity, will show us how come that the Bell brand and the Uganda Waragi brand have achieved what they have achieved. Thank you very much. Ladies and gentlemen, we also have on screen our very own Mr. Mark Pongom Ochiti, who is the MD of Serengeti Breweries in Tanzania. Mark used to be the managing director for Uganda Breweries. Mark also has an oil and gas background and is a believer in sustainability. Welcome, Mark, all the way from Dar es Salaam.
Thank you.
We were expecting Baker Magunda, who from Nigeria. I don't know whether he's been able to join us. If he joins us, we will introduce him. But panelists, let me start with each of you. We are not just celebrating 75 years. We are not just celebrating money. We are also celebrating leadership and thought leadership. And Jane, when I look at your CV, whether on LinkedIn or anything, you are the first group managing director, female, the chair of COVID-19. There's something that you have done that obviously gives you the success. Please share with us that story. Okay, please go ahead. I think we had a problem with the microphone. We could have lost you. Can you just repeat that, please?
Okay, so I said thank you very much, Jimmy, for agreeing to chair and come and celebrate with us today. I think when I get a specific task or objective, I reflect on what I need to deliver. And almost 100% of the times is about the people around me. So I try to surround myself with great talent. And I was just mentioning, for example, you as a board member, the challenge, the build, the steer is important. Surrounding myself with great people, Alvin, Mark, and others in the room and elsewhere. I think that's about it. Mm. Who do you have around your table to help you deliver what you must?
Thank you, Jane. Who do you have around the table? Those of you who are leadership students get that story. Alvin, what a success story. I hate to remind everybody that I happened to be in that interview when you came at Shell and kind of saw the gem in you. But I look at your story as well. It is such a success story. Becoming the finance director for Shell in East Africa, being a finance director for Kenya, being a finance director for Uganda, growing to be an MD, and now going to be a regional director for Diageo. What are the nuggets of success?
To be honest, Jimmy, there's no real one formula. And you know, sometimes you have to be very humble about life, that a number of things happen and you're able to take your opportunities as they come along. But one piece that has really been consistent, and when I engage with young people across, I have a passion for mentoring young people, is I talk about their internal set of advisors. I've been very blessed from a very young age, as good as being through campus, to have individuals who I really, you know, saw myself walking their shoes, the way they carried themselves, the way they role model themselves. And sometimes it's not about what we say in such symposiums. It's about the consistency of the values we exude. And as young people see us exuding those values, how do they adopt them? But one thing I've really taken time and I talk to young people about is, who are your mentors? Who are your coaches? Who are your sponsors? Who are you going to seek out and be vulnerable to share about your dreams, your aspirations, your direction, your vision? And in sharing that vision, direction, aspirations, they tend to then start to hold your hand and say, go this way, I made a mistake here, go this way. Because if we are lucky, life is quite short, you know, 70, 80 years. Why not borrow from the wisdom of those who've gone before you and be humble enough to listen, to experiment, and adopt? I think for me, that would be the short version of it. And I'm still on a journey, not yet a finished product, but I'll be humble to always listen to my advisors.
Thank you. Humility, mentorship, great words, Alvin. Marion, welcome.
Thank you very much.
Coming from the oil and gas sector, it is difficult for you to relate with the beer, but here we are.
Yes, indeed, one of the things I have to really say is that my journey of learning really, really started at Uganda Breweries. Uganda Breweries was the most amazing learning academy that I have ever experienced. When it came to marketing, when it came to leadership, the two values that spoke to me and still speak to me and have remained with me and keep driving me are the value around freedom to succeed and also being the best. And it is something that I also impart on the people I work with. I was given the freedom to succeed. There were very challenging times, especially around the inability to meet the demand of the market. But we had the freedom to succeed. So it is something that I have grown with and I impact in my personal life and also at work. Being the best is something we have to strive for. For whatever you can't achieve, at least try. Try and always deliver to the best of your ability. So those for me have been the nuggets that have lived with me and will continue to live with me. Thank you.
Thank you, Marion. And again, for those of you who are leaders or who are aspiring to be leaders, give people freedom and then they will give you their best. That's great, and I'm sure many of us can learn from that. Mark, great guy. You've done a lot of good things. You are a believer in yourself. You're a great gopher. You combine many things. Just share with us your leadership nuggets.
The things that we achieved, therefore, my team and I gave me a hell of a lot of pride. I've been a corporate leader for a number of years now, and I'm one of those that Alvin is talking about, because my time is now about giving back to society. It's no longer about taking away, but giving back to society. And my personal leadership purpose revolves around people and community development. So leadership in Uganda Breweries at the time that I was there gave me the opportunity to display that in a way that created meaningful change for many, many people. I'm grateful to be part of this panel, and hopefully we'll have the opportunity to share some of those experiences.
Thank you, Mark. And I think Mark also reminds me that behind management is a board. And our board members are not here, but our Uganda Breweries board is chaired by Japheth Kato. It's got a few other board members who may be in the room. We have Rachel Dumba, we've got myself, we've got Eric Kiniti, and we also have Jane and Alvin. So those are the board members for Uganda Breweries. But above Uganda Breweries, there is the East African Breweries Diageo, and again, great leaders. So just like you've heard everybody saying, it's about the people you work with, it's about the space you are given, it's about the ability to strive, and the board at East African Breweries is chaired by Dr. Martin Odror. The vice chair is John O'Keefe, who is the president for Diageo in Africa. You've got Carol Mushoka. You've got Ori Ola Hakola. You've got John Olanga from Tanzania. You've got Leo Brin. You've got Rispa Ohaga. You've got Dale Naiga, who is the managing director for Diageo Great Britain. You've got Japheth Kato, Jane, and myself. So that's what forms the East African Breweries that is headquartered in Nairobi. But Jane, I want to come back to you and in one of the things you said. Speaking about pioneering, you were appointed in January as the first ever female group MD of East African Breweries. Your management team is so many ladies. Just tell us what it feels to be a trailblazer.
Thank you, Jimmy. I think it all starts with the vision of the business. So at East African Breweries and Diageo, we talk about trust and respect. So for you to gain trust and respect, you have to get to your consumers, the right brands, and in the right way. The consumers are 50-50, because we have consumers in the world. It's 50% male, 50% females. So I think as Diageo, because we want to be trusted and respected, we have to reflect internally what external space is. And by doing that, we think we'll attract more consumers, we'll attract better employees. And in fact, yesterday somebody made a joke with me that men tend to work better when they are mixed together with women. I think they want to show up. So when you have a diverse, I think it's a factory. When I was going around the factory at UBL, an Alfred told me, guys like to show off their abilities. So if you have a diverse team, you get to perform better. So our ambition is quite ambitious. We want to be the most trusted, respected consumer goods in Africa. And for us to do that, we have to make sure that we are diverse in thought, so that we can drive performance. Mm. How it feels? I think I feel special, but on the other hand, I prefer to call myself a leader, not a female. Because the minute I say I'm a female leader, I may be doubting my own belief. So I'm a leader, like Mark is saying, is a corporate leader. And therefore, I see other women and the role model I do is that we can do as good as anybody. So it's about our performance, it's about the skills we give ourselves, about the way we lead, the way we relate to people, the way we give back to society, the way we give back to even our employees, and the way we get challenged and built, and the way we rely on experiences like of the board, for example.
Mm. Yeah. Thank you, Jane. Indeed, inclusiveness and the diversity agenda is not just a small thing. But Mark, I want to come back to you. In 2016, you were at the helm of Uganda Breweries as the MD, and under Mark, and under your leadership, can you hear me, Mark?
Yes, I can hear you, Jimmy.
Great. Yes, and under your leadership, there was a significant investment in the sustainability agenda. In fact, you are credited for driving the Roots National Reforestation Campaign. There's so much to cover in the ESG space these days, the environment, social, and governance. But talk us through, you know, that whole initiative and what is it that drove a beer company to get into that space of sustainability?
Yeah, thank you very much, Jimmy. Like I said in my introductory remarks, my personal leadership purpose, what I really wake up to do every day, revolves around livelihood and community improvement. So anytime I'm given the opportunity to, I like to default to programs that enhance the quality of living through positively contributing to communities in which we operate. So for me, that meant that Uganda Breweries' agenda and my agenda sort of came into sync, which was a very good thing. So you've talked about our Society 2030 program, and under that, our initiatives focused around programs on environmental degradation, enhancement of tertiary education. You talked about the amount of money that we spend today, even today, on education in the tertiary area. Improvement of sanitation and education on the safe use of alcohol in society, and of course, the dangers of underage consumption. And I can talk at length about these things, Jimmy, the things that we did and the initiatives that we held, and quote a number of statistics as I speak. For example, the fact that we committed and spent 1% of our annual post revenue to support the needs of communities under these programs, or facts like we invested $4 million out of our bottom line to expand our water effluent plant to ensure that the water that we pumped out of Lake Victoria, or pumped back into Lake Victoria, went back into the lake in a cleaner state than when we extracted it. And this, of course, was a huge sense of pride for us, because in essence, it meant that we provided clean water for the community around. Scholarships that were awarded to students to study in places like Kitgumon and Kabale, or the fact that today Uganda loses 96,000 every year. And because of that, we signed a pact with NFA, as well as with Rotary Uganda, to help jointly restore forest reserves in the Lake Victoria catchment area. All these, Jimmy, to me, are just statistics. And I can go on quoting them over and over and over again. What is really important, what was really important for us as a business at the time, was to pull out, and still is to pull out, the real life enhancing stories of all the stuff that we did. And if you just give me a minute, Jimmy, I would like to share one of those stories with you.
Please.
In 2019, like I said, we had a pact or a partnership with Rotary Uganda. So one of the clubs in Kampala invited us to participate in a water project in Bududa in eastern Uganda. And I spoke to the chairman of the club, and he assured me that this particular project was going to be unlike any that we had ever participated in as a brewery. And he invited me to personally attend the launch of the project to see for myself what he meant. So on the allotted day, because like I said, issues of improvement and people's livelihood are very close to my heart. On the allotted day, it was a Saturday morning, I woke up at 5 o'clock in the morning and drove to Bududa, to a village called Bowali. And when I got to Bowali, what I saw there really shocked me. So the village of Bowali is about 45 minutes outside Bududa, which for those of you who are not sure of the geography of Uganda, is just outside Mbale town, which is in eastern Uganda, on the foothills of Mount Elgon. And as we drove towards the village, I noticed that everywhere I looked around me, at least two out of every five of the people that I saw was physically deformed in one way or the other. So some of them had issues with their legs, some of them had issues with their arms, some of them had deformed foreheads, and there was deformity everywhere I looked. And at first I thought I was imagining this. But then we drove up and got to this village, Buwali, and I found a number of American students there, PhD students in the village. And I asked them what they were doing there. And it was only then that I learned that this village, this particular village, Buwali, in this place called Bududa, has the highest number of disabled people per capita in Uganda, and probably in Africa. And of course, that got my curiosity, and I started to ask why. And what the students told me they had discovered is that it was because the people in the village, their only source of fresh water was at the bottom of the mountain. And that fresh water came from the top of the mountain and flowed down through natural gullies or rivers or waterfalls into wells at the bottom of the valley. And these people went and got water from there every day and had been doing so for generations. However, over the generations, because of deforestation, the trees in that area had been felled. And because of that, the soil had been left exposed. And so the water, which normally collected all its minerals and nutrients on the way down from the top of the mountain, started to lose its course and went through areas where there were no more minerals to be collected. And so it happened that the people at the bottom of the valley were consuming water without the natural minerals that they needed to strengthen their bones, things that we take for granted. And as a result, a lot of them were deformed. So this is why we were doing this water project. We were doing two things. One, to try and reforest the area, to try and replant trees, but also two, to provide the people in the area with fresh water. And what the project involved was building some water ducts from the top of the mountain and directing this water down to big tanks at the bottom of the valley where the residents of the village could collect it. And in doing so, hopefully, provide the residents of the village with mineral-filled water once again, so as to give hope to future generations. And then, of course, reforesting the area and planting trees so that the natural mineral enhancement of the drinking water comes back over time. So it is real stories like this, Jimmy, stories of real impact that we had on the people through the projects that we did that inspired us to continue our investments. So statistics can be quoted, but I think what really makes the difference is the difference that we really make in the lives of the people that we touch through the projects that we do. So the Roots campaign was nothing other than the fact that we recognized that there was a lot of deforestation in Uganda. Like I said, 96,000 hectares of land every year being lost, hectares of forest being lost as a result of deforestation. And therefore the recognition that we were running out of trees, and that is what Roots really stood for. And therefore we needed a decisive and affirmative action in going back to reforest Uganda. So that's what it was about. And I'm so proud to have played my part in actually enhancing the lives of the people in the areas of those kind of projects that we did.
Mark, that's a great story. I think when we talk about making the difference real, that is making the difference in people's lives real. And this is what we say when we talk about sustainability. It is not about producing the sustainability reports and having good graphs in there, but it's really, really going to the ground and impacting the people. And maybe even at this juncture, let me take the opportunity to thank a number of our stakeholders. There are a lot of stakeholders who have helped us make a lot of these things possible. the media teams, the newspapers, the government, the communities, the people we work with when we are doing some of these things in our value chain. All these have contributed to our 75 years. But Alvin, as Mark was speaking about the relationship with lottery, and you've been in the papers last week forming partnership, and there is that saying that you are only as strong a company as the people you surround yourselves with. Can you speak to Uganda Breweries' strategic partnerships? How do they deliver into delivering the shareholder value?
Thank you, Jimmy. I mean, first of all, I'm still quite moved by Mark's story, because in as much as he began the project, I came back to actually commission it. So Mark, over a beer, we will talk about what I saw with rolling out the project to make it come alive, and what that water project has meant to the communities in that village. It's been a real, real difference. So Mark, thank you for starting the journey, and yes, I did finish the race and the project went live. Now back to your question, Jimmy, around stakeholder partnerships. Essentially, one of the key wisdoms we've carried along in celebrating 75 years today is that we've realized we are stronger together. We've realized we can go further together. And in as much as you've seen us in the papers the last few weeks, you know, there are many stories to share. You know, our interest in agriculture, which is the backbone of this country in terms of employment and a key GDP, and how it can run off the multiplier effect. You know, if I talk about specifically LRM, local raw material sourcing, and what we've done in the last 15 years where we've really meant business between 2006 and now, where 2006 we only sourced 1% of our inputs from within Uganda, to last year when we sourced 92% of all our inputs within Uganda, investing about 45 billion in our farmers. I can tell you without a doubt that Uganda Breweries or any other business in our sector without the right local sourcing programs would not even have survived COVID. Because how are we going to import sorghum, maize grits through one border, two tests? When would Ugandans enjoy their favorite drinks? But because 15 years ago, you know, the leaders who came before us decided, listen, we must create a business that creates shared value. And Jane, thank you for the article on the weekend. I borrowed a bit from that. We must create a business that has something around winning for everyone, not winning just we're gonna breweries. And that has become a deeply entrenched ethos for us as we go forward. So I can go back to a few examples. You know, Kapchorwa Farmers Association, we worked with them from 2 decades ago. We managed to support them to get particular financing to build a computerized and automated plant, which now processes about 600 tons of cereals per month. It was working with 700 farmers, now it's working with 6,300 farmers. I can then move on to the latest arrangement that we had with the OWC, which is really around building capacity and capability with the farmers and facilitating research. I can move on to Naro, that is doing a similar role. I can talk about Kakira, who we are now being able to localize and source our spirits from Uganda. But now, even better, it is also really supporting the EABL cause, because all of a sudden, EABL is not going to South Africa or Mauritius to get spirits. We are sourcing all our spirits from Uganda, the Pearl of Africa. This is what partnerships do. They enable us to grow our ecosystem. They enable us to grow shared value. And when we talk ESG, it no longer starts to sound like this term that you want to roll out of a sustainability report, but you start to realize that, and I think one time when I was presenting in April, I talked about the shared value that is created by the various players, from 33% of our top line going to just the revenue authorities. But you realize that if tomorrow you pulled out, Uganda Breweries from this story and this narrative, that the actual impact will be in 93% of the ecosystem. The shareholder only gets 7% of total returns. 93% is in Ugandan lives. Close to 4 million households are directly or indirectly influenced by us waking up to provide our brands and build those brands. That is the narrative.
Thank you. And the narrative of creating shared value in the ecosystem is a key mantle for me. I sit and I see your neighbor on the left as a head of social affairs in the Tilenga Oil and Gas Project. I'm sure the story that creating shared value that Alvin and Mark talk about is the envy of what the oil project should stay as a legacy in the country. But let's move to another aspect and take you back in probably the more interesting days of being marketing director, Marion. And Uganda Breweries has been at the heart of many sponsorship. We've sponsored games, we've sponsored sports, we've been in this hall, seen the best jazz musicians in town. What would you say about the socio-economic transformation of these industries that UBL has contributed?
I have to say that art, sports, and music have, over the years, had a very substantial contribution to the socio-economic development of this country. The sustainability of a lot of what we do is actually enshrined in what used to be called in those days the Millennium Development Goals, and today is called the Sustainable Development Goals. So if we take SDG 3, which is about well-being and health, and then SDG 4, which is about culture, education, you actually see that all these sponsorships that we've been undertaking have not just been for the sake of, they've actually contributed substantially to a lot of elements which we've been seeing over the years. The investment that Uganda Breweries put into, for example, sports can be remembered. There are a lot of events. For example, Bell Lager sponsored Bell FC. It was for a very, very long time. Bell also sponsored the Super League. And the number of youth who participated in those programs, who went through, would not have, in that period, gone through most of those football events, and they would not be where they are today. I tried actually looking at some of the names, and I noticed that many of them have gone to play beyond Uganda. One or two of them played also for the Cranes, but also are playing in other countries. If I take rugby, Guinness has sponsored rugby, Bell sponsored rugby. Bell sponsored rugby most especially when it was needed. For a long time, we only had one rugby club in Lugogo, and today it's called Legends. Chadondo, as many of us know it today, actually didn't exist. It would flood, but one day somebody came and got the lease from KCC. Then they came to us and said, we want to start this thing. But because if we had not been visionary enough to support other companies, like even Hima, would not have actually come in to support Chadondo. Look at what it became. It's not just about rugby. It became a place where, you know, young people, adults, people leaving work in the evening would go and play even other sports or even exercise. Fortunately, there was also a bar, and most of our brands were also sold. at not just this bar, but a lot of the bars where we actually had, where we were supporting, such as the two rugby clubs that came about. We also, through our brand Pilsner, did a lot of sports events in the region. And also, there was sports events like the Buganda Botry Gala. And with that, we also, I must say, had a lot of, have given a lot of support to the kingdoms, especially around the coronations. Our brands were there when the king, the current king of Toro was coronated, when the current king of Buganda, when the Alur king, when the rot of Acholi, we've been there. And we are still supporting many of these coronation events because I keep seeing them in the media. Now, when it comes to music, Bell has been there through the years. And through a lot of the entertainment events, our brands were present. We supported Miss Uganda. But like with a lot of life cycle curves, we decided to look for an event and created an Oscar-feeling event when we brought the Pearl of Africa Music Awards. It became the ticket that everybody wanted. The first year, it was just an event in Kampala, but with the subsequent years, we took it to the regions, and it became such a major event. There were a lot of artists who went through or who were recognized, who were discovered through these events that we were doing. Today, the Bell All-Stars is also happening. A lot of artists who perform, many of them, I don't know their names, but I know their music. So you see an event, you can recognize the music. And I'm so proud that we've continued to contribute not just to the experiences that this music provides, but to the whole concept of the arts, sports, music. Now, I cannot leave this without talking about our contribution to the advertising agent, to the advertising agency industry. When we started out with all our campaigns, it was traditional media, television, radio, print. And I have to commend the media for supporting us over the years. But we also started having to get closer to the consumer. So we started doing experiential events. The first companies, some of you may not remember, but there were companies like Group Africa, all the way from South Africa. And they were the ones who were doing these experiential events. But with time, more and more local experiential companies came about. With over the years, I've seen them doing events in Rwanda, doing events in Southern Sudan. So, and I know them personally. I know the journey that they have gone through. Mm-hmm. And it would not have been possible without Uganda Breweries. With that in mind, all this has actually grown the brand health, the affinity that our consumers have for our brand. And it's quite commendable that all this has contributed to the socioeconomic development of the economy and will continue to do so.
Thank you, Marion. I think even as you are talking, I grew up in Naguru, so I know that rugby field and rugby used to be played by only white guys. Mm-hmm. Today, Uganda has a rugby 7 team, which competes internationally. So thanks to the journey of Bell, but also the story you bring of agencies. I remember our own days in Shell, we had to bring in agencies from Nairobi. Today, you're talking about agencies in Uganda, and all that is part of the journey of our 75 years. But Marion, I don't want to leave you because you've got a personal story, and if we may allow, let me bring it up. Because at the helm of the distillery of the Uganda Waraji industry was your mother. She was a pioneer woman in the leadership in Uganda.
Did that inspire your own journey to join the breweries?
Not directly, because my mother, Mrs. Eva Dengo, worked for Uganda Development Corporation from the late 70s into the early 80s. And all the parastatals, the distillery, the sugar companies, the hotels, were actually all under UDC. So with liberalization, the government decided to start selling off a lot of these companies. So they got individuals from Uganda Development Corporation, UDC, to go and oversee these transactions. So my mother was sent to what was East African Distilleries Limited at the time. So eventually the company was bought by International Distillers and Vintners. When the owners came in, she left. Very many years later, there was an advert in the papers. I happened to be working in advertising. There was an advert in the papers, and I did the interview for a brand manager, and that's how I joined. But with respect to how that how she inspired me is, she was actually, there were only two women at the time who from UDC who were sent to run all these companies, and she was one of them. She was a wife, she was a mother. And what for me that spoke to me about was, it was possible. Anything was possible. It was possible for a woman to actually be in a position of leadership. It was possible for someone to actually undertake all these tasks with great integrity. And that is something that has stayed with me to this day. And it's something that I keep also talking to a lot of young women about, even old women, about how it is that you can actually stay and steer such big ships. Thank you.
Thank you, Marion, for sharing that personal story. I wasn't sure you'd accept it. I'm going to propose we do a comfort break for 5 minutes, but as you also watch some of the great advertising and marketing that we've been doing over the last 75 years.
Did you know that Downy Concentrate softens and freshens 2.5 more clothes per liter than the leading fabric softener? It's more concentrated, so use only 1/3 of a cap. Get one sachet of Downy Concentrate at 500 shillings.
Want a kick-ass game? Have a good night's sleep.
Get brand new Always Dreams with a wider back and leak guard channels that lock liquid no matter how you move.
A good night's rest, a kick-ass game.
OneXBet operates under Advanced Gaming Limited and is licensed and regulated by the National Lotteries and Gaming Regulatory Board. Betting is addictive and can be psychologically harmful, and it is eligible to persons above 25 years of age.
Let the elders that rule well be counted worthy of double honor, especially they that labor in the word and in doctrine.
We are on the cusp of something special, and it all comes down to this. This is what we live for, and our very destiny is hinged on this moment. Our moment to recognize, celebrate, and show the world that the Wise Teacher Ministries, in reverence, love, ceremonious love, adoration, bestow the highest form of double upon double honor to you, the greatest prophet alive today, Prophet Elvis Mbonye.
And I'm so grateful to God for the gift that you are to our generation.
The next episode is brought to you by... On on the next episode.
You're working with Caridad? Does she suspect us and want to separate us?
No, no way. What I can assure you is that I'm going to make her life impossible.
It's very clear to me that you are both talented.
You really deserve this one, sweetheart. Now there won't be any trouble in our families.
Looks like you still have a lot of work to do, right? And you're not leaving until this floor is completely dry and clean, okay? Are there any problems?
No. None.
That's good.
Okay, are you really, really super, super, super sure you want to get married to Franco?
Of course I am, Clara. I love Franco. I love being with him. Why do you ask?
You get jealous easily?
Are you crazy, Marintia? Eladio Gomez Luna is our enemy? No!
Yes, I am crazy.
What are you doing?
Eladio Gomez Luna.
Lower your skirt. Lower your skirt, Marintia. He will take Gabriela's side. Think!
Of music and entertainment, NTV got you covered.
That's why my baby said,
you are my fantasy.
There's no way till the water's dry.
Take your lunch break in style with me, Crystal Panav and Bem DJ. Join me every single day from Monday to Friday from 2:30 p.m. to 3:30 p.m. on The Vibe right here on NTV Uganda.
On the beat, we bring your favorite artists from within and of course beyond our country's borders.
No more damages now. Tell me what you need from me.
And of course, when it comes to giving you the most accurate information and news about the Ugandan music industry, nobody got you like we do.
Young, you are coaching them. I wanna see you regular.
Let's go!
Look down, throw it all in the corner.
Nobody kickstarts your weekend like we do. That's why we are NTV.
We are the masters of Friday night. What else?
DJ Baby Lover, you lay the love. Produce and you sing fan. And you the girl, them put the blessing fan.
Deep in love, you the one on my mind every second. You the one that I'm thinking of.
Yo, weekend jams never stop, yeah? Keep it locked every Saturday, 1:30 p.m. right on NTV. We are the show and the business. Expose.
Level.
Hey, yo, what's poppin'? What's up? This is your Augment Saturday Night Show.
It is the biggest party in the land. Partners with some of the biggest brands in the land. Let's dance the night away.
And now every single Saturday night, 10 p.m. exclusive on NTV, we're the NTV Dance Party.
TV's hottest stage with the freshest names in the game. Fresh music. Your hosts Linda Dane, Sammy Watala, and Daggy Nice. Catch NTV The Beat every weekday at 5 p.m. We are NTV The Beat, and we turn on your musical world.
Welcome back to the UBL at 75 Deep Dive. We are celebrating life every day, everywhere. And today we are doing that by taking you through our journey of 75, our contribution to helping people have a good life and our contribution to helping Uganda grow. Jen, I did notice today we launched the sustainability report by the group chair. Do you want to tell us what that is about and put it in context for us as Uganda Breweries?
Thank you, Jimmy. So this morning we had the pleasure of launching our first sustainability report as an EABL company. And obviously Uganda is part of EABL, so it's featured very, very strongly. As EABL, but we want to talk a lot more so that we can be thought leaders, other like-minded individuals who can drive this agenda with passion, because like we are all aware, it's getting to really getting bad from an environmental perspective. The other thing is that I talked earlier about we are a grain to glass industry. We have a very strong value chain across our business in all the countries where we operate. So therefore, from an environmental perspective or ESG perspective, we are driving several actions. One is climate action, gender and inclusivity and diversity, and water. Let me start with water because we've had a lot of water and a great example from Mark and Alvin, and I don't want to go again over that, other than give statistics that we have provided across East Africa and saved about 180,000 metric hectoliters of water. That's a lot in terms of water replenishment investments we've had to drive green energy across our site. So we are starting in UBL, and there is one in Kisumu, and there is one in Nairobi. From a replenishment perspective, we're also investing a lot on water filtration systems and sewer systems. And I think there's a great example across in UBL, in Kenya, in Dar es Salaam, in Moshi, in Mwanza, across all our sites. I think the other thing I want to talk about in relation to a question you asked me earlier is the inclusion. It's about IND. And in 2019, Diageo was recognized as one of the top 100 FTSC companies in the world in driving inclusion and diversity agenda from board level to the lowest ranks of the organization. Now, at EABL, we are driving it also across the entire value chain. So when we start with farmers, we are insisting and ensuring that we have equal representation from a female number of farmers who are providing us with grain and any other supplier, be it advertising agencies. In Kenya, we just run a very serious program where we have a lot of female suppliers from advertising agencies, including directors who have been directing ads and stuff. In the business with employees, we have an ambition to get to 50-50 by year 2026. We know that's quite audacious. We are working on it, and we have very many programs to ensure that we are getting equal representation from interview stage, and also more importantly for the leadership to overcome unconscious bias, because we know the championing of diversity has to be across all employees, not just females. Alvin has to be a champion, Mark has to be a champion wherever they are working. So running those programs to get us ready, and also to make sure that we are doing everything within our organizations to be fair to every gender. The other thing we are doing is at the outside, I mean, in terms of front end of the business, the trade, we've trained a lot of barmen. I think even in this market, we launched the Diageo, put it back to the bar, raise the bar. We're spending $5 million in Dar es Salaam, Kampala, and Nairobi to train bartenders. And so far across East Africa, we've trained 5,000 of them so that they can get the right capability to serve our consumers better. And also helping some of those bars overcome the problems or the challenges that have been brought about by COVID-19. So I think to summarize, Jimmy, we want to make sure that across the chain, from grain to glass, we are demonstrating to every stakeholder about how we are bringing shared value to communities of where we are working. So the shareholder gets their part, the employee gets their part, the suppliers get their part. And our trade, our distributors, and the communities where we live in, everybody's thriving so that we can be sustainable for the next N years, for a very, very long time to go. So that's why we are launching this, and I think, please have a look at it. I think it's a very, very rich report, and I think we are hoping that other people can learn from it, and other people also can write to us and tell us how else we can improve. We already have strong partnerships, for example, UN Compact, and I can tell you, we are driving in Kenya, in particular, 13 of the 17 SDGs in everything that we do, and we see a lot of that rolled out in.
I think the issue of sustainability, the issue of the ESG, the environment, social, and governance, is a big item, a big agenda item on the board of East African breweries. But I think the key thing I liked in what Jen said is that those are some of the things we can share, because collectively we've got something to do around the environment. We have to do something around the climate change. So if we can play our role, if we can share some of that best practice with other companies so that collectively we can change climate change, I think we would have done a great job. But Mark, still on sustainability, can you talk to us about the Uganda Brewery's plastic usage agenda, championing it and eventually effecting the sachet ban? We had a lot of problems with those sachets, and I think we need to thank the government again as one of the key stakeholders for having helped us. Just talk to us about that plastic usage agenda in UBL.
Thank you very much, Jimmy. Before I go into that, I want to just touch on something that Alvin talked about, which is about shared prosperity. And, you know, like I said, I like to tell personal stories because it is the stories that bring what we do to life. And when Alvin talked about shared prosperity, it is not something that you should just think of as one way, because a lot of the examples he was giving us about what we've been able to achieve as a result. If you look at what we have enabled people in the communities where we do business, or where Uganda Breweries does business, to improve their lives, it is amazing. And there's this story that I like to tell about a guy called Odong, who lives in Kumi, and who had dropped out of school. He was about 19 years of age when we started doing work with him in about 2019. And we started buying cassava from him, cassava flour from him to make beer. And over a 3-year period of time, he moved from planting half an acre of cassava on his father's plantation to becoming an outgrower of cassava. He employed about 50 youth around cassava so that he could buy it from them and sell it to us. And in that period, he moved out of a grass-thatched wattle house, a hut, which he showed us when we went to see him in his village, to a 3-bedroom Mabati house with power and with flowing water. So it's examples like that that show you that shared prosperity is really a two-way thing, and why we're proud to do the things that we do or did with the community. So just talking about plastics, Jimmy, you know, one of the most enviable things about Uganda Breweries, and one of the things that I miss today, is the office location. And a lot of Ugandan, all Kampala residents like to have a little glimpse, a little view of the lake. You find them talking about, I have a little lake view, I have a view of the lake and stuff like that. In Uganda Breweries, when you sit in those offices, you actually have the full lake view. And it is very, very enviable. In fact, a lot of times you benefit from the nice lake breeze if you care to open your windows and allow it in. The sad thing about that, though, is that sitting in Uganda Breweries and sitting in the office that I sat in, is that you are also witness to the full-scale degradation of Lake Victoria. In the 3 years of my occupying that corner office, I was witness to the color of the lake turn from a nice deep blue shade, especially in the afternoons when the sun hit it, to what is today deep green. And all that only in 3 years. And all that due to pollution. Due to the pollution in Kampala. So again, a little statistic. Kampala today, Kampala in 2015 generated 3,200 tons of waste per day. Today, it is generating in the region of 4,000 tons per day. And 90% of this waste goes into Lake Victoria. That at least 20% of this waste is recyclable plastic. You know, all the little water bottles that we use, all the Kavera that we use in Kampala, it all ends up into Lake Victoria. And it is beginning to choke the lake beyond repair. And you see this live when you have a view like the one that we have in Uganda Breweries. And so this is a sad scene that we're faced with. And it is something that as Kampala residents, as Ugandans, as East Africans, as Africans, we must all be concerned about. And this is where our program on waste management, especially plastic, comes in. So in recognition of all this, Uganda Breweries decided to go green in 2018. And we set about to discontinue the use of non-recyclable plastic in our process distribution and manufacture. Remember, we used to sell Uganda Waraji in sachet, what was popularly known as sachet. And we made a decision, which at the time affected our business negatively, to actually get out of sachet manufacturing. Because we recognized that it was having a negative impact on the environment. At the time we did it, we were pioneers in the industry in pulling out. And like I said, it affected us negatively as a business. But thankfully, we were able to work with government and let them see our point of view, in the sense that by encouraging the rest of the industry to get out of sachet, they would actually be playing a part in sustaining and improving or maintaining the environment. And so they came along with us, and some time later, sachet was actually banned. And so we're proud to have played a part in that. We still have a long way to go in delivering a completely green operation. But the plan under our Sustainability 2020 plan is that by the year 2030, 100% of our packaging material will be widely recyclable, and at least 60% of that will be made from recyclable material. And I think the goal, if I remember, is to achieve zero plastic waste by the year 2030.
Thank you, Mark. I think that's a real example of our contribution to society. But Alvin, we have a shareholder. So we do all these things for the farmers, all these things for the environment, but there is a shareholder. And there is also another stakeholder. We are among the top taxpayers in this country. This is a huge contribution to the economy. As I said, almost 400 billion shillings last year, 7.4 trillion shillings over the years in paying taxes. Talk about our contributions to the economy of Uganda as UBL.
Thank you, Jimmy.
And maybe through the value chain. Please just turn that microphone close to
I
you.
I think
as
it's
well.
Okay now. Mm-hmm. So thank you, Jimmy. As we've
fielded a whole array of questions around sustainability and really worked that topic. You must understand that the entities of today, before you even get to best performing, which is how much shareholder value are you extracting, you must delve into the aspects of, are you trusted and respected? A number of our consumers, our partners through the value chain, partner with us because of the values they believe Uganda Breweries and its brands stand for. And for us, as we talk about performance today, we know that the first anchor for us is how do we engage with community. The first anchor with us is how do we exude our values through our ecosystem, be it farmers, distributors, outlets, our own employee base. The first anchor for us is where do we make a stand? And you shared some very good numbers earlier, so I won't go to the list of numbers. You know, maternity leave being at 6 months, paternity leave being at 1 month, and actually in the last 1 year, we have seen more employees take paternity leave than maternity leave. We thought it would be the other way around, but it was an opportunity for all. You know, making those stands is not easy. You know, Mark just spoke about, you know, coming out of sachet a few months earlier before the whole sector moved. 70% of your spirits volume. But we know that performance is made by decisions that serve the long-time horizon of a better community. Now, it's very easy to step back and say, we've seen your numbers we are listed across the three markets. It's very easy to say, we've seen your numbers, you're growing double digit, 24% in spirits, 46% in beer. But I want to step back from that and say, those are just numbers. The anchor for us is that what is our currency in transforming lives? As I speak to you right now, Jimmy, we do a socioeconomic study every year. And we've measured of late that we contribute close to 0.4% of the GDP. We employ close to 1% of the current workforce, whether directly or indirectly. Talking about our 32,000 farmers who support millions of homes, going on to our distributors, who are about 36 main distributors, with about 3,000 stockists who we work very directly with, going out into our outlets, which are close to on-trade and off-trade, 120,000. Then to our employees, direct and indirect, who come close to 1,500. That's an ecosystem. And each of that part of the ecosystem must be sold on to what is our vision, what is our direction, what is our mission. So when we talk performance and we think about what can really sustain us, is how do you get into the business of creating collective mission where all of us embrace this vision, and whether we'll have ups and downs, we'll have the spirit to stick it out. That really speaks to what is at the anchor of our performance story to date.
Thank you, Alvin. And not only are we having great performance, paying a lot of taxes, creating shareholder value, but also in terms of safety. We have seen, which is probably a great envy to those of us who work in other industries, 12 million man hours of no lost time injury. That is huge. That is on average, if you add it up, is almost 23 man years. That we have not had somebody not work because of an injury because he works for us. And that is how we take safety, performance, and getting respected seriously. But Alvin wants to add on something on safety.
I mean, of course, we saw recently that we got the accolades around Brewery of the Year across all Diageo sites. So Uganda Breweries was mentioned and named Brewery of the Year as it turned 75 years, which is really amazing. But similarly, on the same day, we also got accolades for becoming the excellent site in safety and well-being across the Diageo network. Remember, Diageo operates in 118 countries, and even in some countries, they have 3 or 4 plants. So to truly lift that trophy on 2 elements, Brewery of the Year, and also excellent standards on safety and well-being, means that for you you're anchored in your routines. You're anchored in always doing better and being better than you are tomorrow. But then, more than anything else, that is a team effort coming from your partners and your ecosystem who've really bought into your mission and your vision.
Yeah, and we really, really, probably also from the board perspective, need to thank our staff, because as we know, safety is a hearts and mind issue. We people come to work unless they have it as a hearts and mind, you're just ticking boxes. So congratulations to UBL. But talking about great accolades, our great brands have also won a lot of accolades. And Marion, I'm sure you remember this, that we have a great story to tell. Our beer, Bell Beer, won many accolades. Our Uganda Waraji has won many accolades. But that wouldn't have been possible without your marketing team, the good advertisements, the good campaigns. Do you remember some of those? And could you maybe share with them? I'm not asking you to sing, but remind us some of those great campaigns.
A Great Night, Good Morning has got to be one of those that sits up there. And it's a pity we don't have Baker with us here, because it was Baker who was behind Great Night, Good Morning. And even Uganda War, we had, I'm not going to sing, but if most people remember the Uganda War, Uganda War, Uganda War, Uganda War, Uganda War, Uganda War, RG. I mean, such great campaigns. And the teams who worked on these campaigns, the marketing teams, also, you know, worked with other departments, because you had the campaigns, you had what you saw in the television advert, then you had to actually go and get the consumers to experience these campaigns in the bars. So the logistics teams were part of it. We would never launch, and I believe it's the same today. You would not launch without taking not just the staff, but even the distributors through what it is that was coming their way. So they all participated in it. One of the greatest campaigns, of course, when it came to Bell, for a long time, beer was in a traditional Euro, what they call a Euro bottle. It was the normal looking basic bottle. And for me, it's a story that is, you know, remains with me, because with all the challenges we were having at the time in production, it was very difficult for us to justify changing the bottle. And yet the world was changing around us. And we needed to change, it's actually on the screen, and we needed to change to this long neck bottle. So eventually, because, I mean, at the time, I mean, I was still very young, and you had the MD of Central Glass. Central Glass was still part of EABL. And I remember having a conversation with him about, okay, how can we do this? Because I've been told there's no money for change parts, there's no money for a new line, there's no money. So he said, don't worry, we shall figure something out. So anyway, eventually, we launched this long neck bottle, and we had to also now come up with all these many campaigns. And even, I mean, I launched the bottle, and then a lot more campaigns came out for Bell. And to this day, it's, as I say, it's really about the people, the agencies, the distributors, the supply chain. So it's marketing is not just done by the marketing team. It is those campaigns, a lot of people participated. And I have to also mention that there is no campaign which was undertaken without undertaking consumer insights. Mm. You had to talk to the consumers in order to get insights to inform the kind of activities and activations that you are going to undertake. That applied across the board. And most interestingly, I mean, we had campaigns, for example, that were global, like, for example, Guinness, Michael Power, for a very long time. We had a various Michael Power campaigns, and I remember initially we had to do a lot of consumer groups to see if it would work in Uganda, because it was new age. The advertising campaigns for marketing power, for micropower had, had helicopter scenes and all these kind of things. But interestingly, the consumer said, no, it will work. Some of the management teams were not so sure, but we said we shall go with what the consumer has said. And besides, it was running also in Kenya, it was running in other countries, Nigeria, and all those countries had gone with what the consumers were saying, and it worked. So that's the story behind a lot of those campaigns and how I believe they're still rolling out today.
And the marketing passion.
Absolutely.
Indeed. And Mark, ever since Uganda Breweries, Diageo bought the majority stake in Uganda Breweries, we've introduced a lot of global brands. I mean, just last week we were celebrating the Blue Johnnie Walker Blue Label with the Blue Label members, who I wish to acknowledge and thank for coming to that event as the patron of the club. But what did that suddenly do for UBL finding itself that now it was playing in global space?
Yeah, I think in answering that question, one would have to delve a little bit into the history of Uganda Breweries. So today we are celebrating 75 years of existence of Uganda Breweries, which meant it was formed somewhere around 1946, so 75 years ago. And through the 75 years, it's gone through a lot of change. Through partnership and acquisition and government intervention and things like that. If you remember, we went through a phase where there was government acquisition of all the companies, state, what they called, all the companies became state-owned, like Marion was saying, under UDC. That was in the late 60s and early 70s. In the early 80s, there was a period of privatization. And that was when Guinness International bought into Uganda Breweries. And I think that was the first point at which Uganda Breweries started to play with international brands, because Guinness, as an international player, coming with a big brand like Guinness, and Marion is talking about the micropower campaigns that were run in the day to try and promote this big brand. And I think the Guinness brand today is still the fastest growing brand in Uganda. Congratulations to what the Guinness team continues to do. But that was the first point of contact with international brands. Guinness International then merged with a company called Metropolitan something to create what we know today as Diageo. And that happened about 1997. And that is the point at which Uganda Breweries then started to get involved with all the international brands that we run today. So things like the International Premium Spirits or the Johnnie Walkers, the reserve brands that you talk about, you just talked about Blue Label, there's all the single malt whiskies and all the reserve vodkas and gin brands that are sold today. So all this has helped to grow the relevance of Uganda Breweries over time, because it meant that from just providing for one palate or one segment of the population, we were able to start to spread our wings. And today, I think we have a product or a beverage for any person across the spectrum of our consumers. So I think there's been a lot of value and benefit in terms of interaction with international brands.
Thank you, Mark. And that brings me to the topic of innovations and Jenny's smiling because every month, every quarter at the board, she has her strategy house and she has a pillar around innovations. Jane, innovations have been at the heart of our business, maybe some of the things that Mark has said. Just talk us through product innovations and from a solutions perspective, of course, without giving away much to our competitors who may be watching. And please talk in the microphone.
Yeah, thank you, Jimmy. So I want to go back and remind you what our purpose is as a business. Our purpose is celebrating life everywhere, every day. So So as we look at innovation, then the first thing we do is keep listening always. We always say listening on to what the consumer is saying out there. And we have many ways in which we listen to the consumers, either through focus groups or just listening within our channels, what consumers are looking for, or how they are enjoying our brands, or how they're also enjoying competition. So we do a lot of consumer research, which then we bring back to the business and look at how the consumer dynamics are changing or evolving, both as to where they are buying, what they are buying, and how they are consuming. And that informs us in terms of what are the next brands from an innovation perspective is. So we do invest a lot of money on innovation. We do a lot of research. We have a very big team that always looks at innovation. But the most important thing is we listen to the consumer moving to whatever direction that they're moving, and we try to stay a bit ahead and ahead of competition. I think the other thing that is quite important is we are, Diageo is a single, is the biggest spirits business in the world. In East Africa now, we are probably the biggest beer business in all, combined, we are the biggest beer business in East Africa. So we have a good portfolio of brands, which A, we can keep line extensions off, we can share the brands across the region, we can import globally, we can play around with spirits and beer, because we are approaching this market as a total beverage alcohol. But at the end of the day, innovations is to answer to every consumer need at whatever time that he wants. So you can have a gin time, a whiskey time, a beer time, and now what a Diageo time, anything that we can offer you. But we're investing a lot in that. Thank you, Jimmy.
Thank you, Jane. And Alvin, we just been, I mean, we're still going through a pandemic, and our hearts and concern goes to all those people who've lost relatives, friends, and all those who have gotten ill and have come out. But I still can't help it without talking about the shutdown. Our bars have been shut down for all this time. Our business has struggled, but we've been innovative in a way. Just help us understand some of the things, again, without giving away a lot, what we have done that has allowed us to grow 33% of our business and grow market share.
All right. Thank you, Jimmy. Allow me to do two things. One, just borrow from what Jane has very ably explained, the ability to listen in. But two, and the ability to listen in, be able to really be as close as we can to our consumers. So we do that, and we've built a muscle around that in terms of a real engine of how we read our environment, how we read our partnerships, and how we read what occasions our consumers are going through. That's only the first part. The second part really is also about the shifting channels. You know, long gone are the days when, you know, you had to come to Kampala, or Kampala was what was holding out the economy. There are a lot of microeconomies, you know, peri-urban areas, deep rural areas, where people are very self-sufficient. And essentially, depending on how you set out your portfolio, you can actually win with a consumer at various ladders. So we're also very keen around the channel and how we serve that channel. But behind these first two points is something, one of my favorite topics, which is really around organizational culture. What routines do we have to truly be able to adapt boldly, orchestrate with impact, and be resilient in our routines? Because at the end of it all, your dynamics will always keep changing. The idea is, how do our brands finally still get to the hands of our consumers, and how do we continue to meet their needs and evolve our portfolio to meet their needs? So for us, it's a lot of listening. It's a lot of outside in that really continues to enable us to adopt and shape not only the current times, but also shape the future and work in line with it. Thank you.
I thought you'd share, and maybe the three of you who are managing businesses in Kenya, Uganda, and Tanzania can also share. We've almost seen an online business. We've seen an Amazon of sorts, yes, coming up out of this pandemic. And I'm just wondering whether in Tanzania or Kenya or Uganda, how that is shaping the channel business, yeah, but also the consumer tests.
Excellent. Maybe I'll go first because I still have the mic. So essentially, we even made, you know, Diageo coin out the word Buddha Buddha and became a real buzzword for home delivery within the ecosystem. Yes, that's still a part of the business, being able to do home delivery and e-commerce. But given the low penetration that we currently still have with Android phones and the youth, we do, yes, believe on the long term, it will definitely be a viable avenue in terms of how we grow our business. But we really believe that other avenues still are going to be dominant for the next 5-10 years more than e-commerce until we get to a stage where we have the right technological penetration with the masses. But yes, it's a channel we are shaping. We have an app called Party Central. We're doing everything to ensure we are shaping that aspect. But we also know that there are other more dominant channels where we need to play better.
Okay. Mark, from Tanzania, do you guys have Boda Boda? Mark, I was just saying that you heard how we've used Boda Bodas, and I was wondering whether there are Boda Bodas in Tanzania or whatever they're called, and how we are using that as a marketing channel. Mark, we can't hear you. We can't hear you, Mark, for some reason. I think your microphone is muted.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, I can.
Can you hear me now?
Yeah, great. I can hear you now.
Can you hear me now?
Yes, I can hear you.
I said, yes, we do have Boda Boda. And I think it's exactly what Alvin said. It is a question of continuously listening to our consumer and understanding A, what they want to be served, and B, how they would like to be served. So when Jane talks about innovation, she talked mainly about product innovation. But innovation cuts across our whole value chain. So where you can talk about route to market innovation as well. And you know, when you listen very keenly to what the consumer wants and how the consumer wants to be served, then it is really easy for you to start to adopt ways in which to serve that consumer. So Boda Boda is only one. Online services are now becoming big as well. So they were not very big in Tanzania before the advent of COVID, but today they're becoming really, really relevant. And I'm sure that as we continue to develop this market, there will be other ingenious ways of servicing the consumer that will come up.
Okay, thank you. And Jane, from all these, I think Kenya would not be any different, but maybe from where you sit as the group managing director, and if you think about the investments that we need to do, tell us some of the future plans of the expansion of the brewery. I mean, after 75 years, are we going to keep the same brewery?
Yeah, thank you, Jimmy. So I think we've continued to invest in this in our businesses even through COVID. I think one of the decisions we made when COVID hit is that we were optimistic that this challenge will go away. And indeed, I'm still optimistic that sooner than later, we'll know how to work around it or it will go away. And we decided to keep investing, one, in our brands. So you've seen investments and advertising going on. We kept on investing on route to market, what Mark is talking about, because they are emerging changes, and therefore we have to keep abreast of the changes and even stay ahead. So we kept investing in e-commerce and other changes, for example, in what we call either Boda Bodas around here in Kenya, or what we call spirits and wines shop became very significant because people are consuming their brands either at home or in other spaces. But more importantly, we've significantly continued to invest in environmental investment so that we can be cleaner. So I talked about earlier, continuing to invest in green energy. And then capacity, we've invested in capacity in Tanzania, a lot of capacity in Uganda, and capacity in Kenya. So because we know we are 75 years now, we are 100 years in Kenya, we want to be here in the next N years, so we can't stop investing. So I'm looking forward to greater investment in this market, so long as the demand is there. And for the consumers, we'll continue investing behind the brands so we can show them what we have and what we are made of, because we have a lot to offer as EABL or as Uganda Breweries in Uganda in terms of giving people different tastes for them to enjoy in their celebrations wherever they are. Thank you, Jimmy.
Thank you. We're running out of time, and I would like to give each of you half a minute to kind of, I don't want to call it a parting shot because we've been here for 75. We want to be there for another 75, but help me with your vision for the next 25 years. What do you see in a few words from each of you? Where do you see us as a brewery? Who wants to go first?
Okay, well, where I would want to see the brewery in many, many years from now is we will have contributed substantially to the SDGs, because ESG is actually enshrined, you know, very squarely across the SDGs. And I think Jane mentioned that there was a focus on 13 out of the 17. So it's not so much to just throw out numbers, but to actually make sure that there is something tangible on each and every one of the 13 that will have been selected. So that's where I would want to see UBL.
Okay, thank you. SDG, which is the Sustainable Development Goals of the UN.
Can I go next?
Yeah.
Excellent. So for me, it's two things. I mean, I'm very excited about even just today morning. Two things. When we are turning 100, Jimmy, and to the audience back home, I would really like to see that UBL was at the center of orchestrating and pulling together partners who are all blue chip. So essentially, we have at least 20 distributors who are listed on the USC, NSC. We have a few media houses and experiential partners, like the likes of Scannard, who work with us in Kenya, also listed in this part of the world. We have farm organizations that are best in class, and that with our existence of 100 years, we will have brought together 100 partners who are essentially blue chip and run with the similar values and ecosystem efforts that we do adopt. And for someone back home who's just about to finish their campus course, they have watched us all morning, and they will decide next year or this year to join this business, because they will be the MD at that juncture, and this show will have proven to be the motivator of why they need to join this great business.
Brilliant. Future MDs, I hope you've heard that. Mark.
Yes, thank you, Jimmy. I think, just like Alvin says, what is going to define Uganda Breweries 25 or another 75 years from today is going to be in the quality of the partnerships that they build. And therefore, for me, what I would like to see is exactly what he's spoken about. How do we get out there and start to ensure that the sustainable partnership that we're talking about, the shared prosperity that we're talking about, actually comes to life and actually starts to mean something for people that in the environments that we do business in? The second thing is around innovation. So innovation needs to continue to be a pillar against which the growth of the brewery is anchored. Like someone once said, if you don't innovate, you die. So that is the second thing I would like to see, that innovation continues to drive the speed at which the company grows. But most importantly, what I would like to see 25 and 75 years from now is, when you talk about Uganda Breweries in the environment, when you talk about Uganda Breweries around Uganda, it is not necessarily, the answer that you will get will not necessarily be about the fact that Uganda Breweries is an alcoholic beverages company, but rather it should be around the impact that Uganda Breweries has had on each and every individual that has heard of or that has been in touch or in contact with Uganda Breweries in any way or shape or form.
Thank you, Mark. And Jen?
Yeah, thank you, Jimmy. So at East African Breweries, we have a very audacious performance ambition. And we want to be, I said earlier, we want to be trusted, respected, across the entire value chain from grain to glass. So I would like, firstly, Uganda Breweries to play a bigger role in the EABL ambition, i.e. means that they need to be bigger. The third one is across the chain from farmer to the consumer, we need and must continue playing our role to share our prosperity and our value with the farmers who supply us with all sorts of things, to the other suppliers who give us other inputs that we require in our manufacturing, to the employees who work with us, to the consumers who consume our brands and the trade who delivers these great products for them. I would say that after in the next 75 years, that UBL is not seen as a brewing company like Mark says, but it's seen as a transformative engine to the social and economic lives of every Ugandan. And I'll stop there. And that will be my criteria for success.
Thank you. I think my own addition on that would say that I would like us to remain and continue being a relevant company in the economy of Uganda, relevant to all stakeholders, relevant to the farmers, relevant to government, relevant to our employees, and relevant to each and everyone who either works or joins in what we do. Ladies and gentlemen, we've been speaking a lot of numbers. I want, first of all, to thank you for listening. I want to thank you for being enthusiastic about our products. We continue celebrating life every day, everywhere. Today, we spoke about innovations. We spoke about diversity and inclusiveness. We spoke about the marketing campaigns. We spoke about our relevance in society. We spoke about the strategic partnership. We spoke about our sustainability goals and our ESG goals. We spoke about our contributions to the economy. And above all, we spoke about our continued investment as Uganda Breweries into this economy. Ladies and gentlemen, join me and let us thank the panelists for a splendid job that they have done, those of you who are here. At that point, I'd like to show you a small video, which is probably less than a minute, that summarizes some of the numbers that we have been speaking about. Thank you very much.
Ladies and gentlemen, welcome back. And wow, what a journey it's been. I feel like I have relived every step of the 75 years of prosperity and shared value. I think for me, Jimmy, you've covered every aspect. One little one that I must not, that I would be remiss by not mentioning is our role in impacting positive drinking in society. We invest disproportionately in protecting the youth against underage drinking, in partnering with the authorities on curbing drink driving in this nation. If I had to put an estimate, it is about 1 billion Uganda shillings annually that we spend in promoting responsible drinking. It is also part and parcel of our sustainability agenda. It is in our best interest to protect our consumers and ensure they are here with us for the next 75 years. So thank you very much once again, ladies and gentlemen of the press. I will now open up our panelists to one or two questions before we dial off the air. So in no particular order, I think we can perhaps start at the back there. Mr. Chamtete, I see you. Thank you very much.
Okay, thank you very much. It's been a great honor to be part of the 75 years. I'm here in very many categories. For me, it's been kind of nostalgic because I did my first business with UBL in 2007. That was the Chogam Business Forum. And we had a nasty pitch, but I think Marion and then the head of marketing gave us the freedom to succeed, and we went ahead and did it. Of course, before I ask my question, is that one of the things I must commend you for, and for anybody who's done business in Uganda, UBL does pay promptly. They pay you in 60 days, but when the 60 days arrive, the system notifies you with an SMS. You don't have to call anybody. And better still, they have a facility with Citibank. If you sign it on, you get advance, you know, the financing. So as soon as you have an LPO, you get financing. And for people who have borrowed money from money lenders in this town at 15% a month, you know what that means. So I must commend you for that job well done. So if you see me, my weight has changed a bit. It's because of UBL. But on a more serious note, looking at what you guys have done with, of course, with the local raw materials program, especially being able to uplift crops like sorghum from, crops that were not known to crops that are earning people billions, I begin to wonder, why does not government, have you tried to engage with government to try and partner with you? Rather than heaping more taxes on you, they should actually be subsidizing you because you've done what many other government-funded agencies have failed to do with their own crops. So I don't know. I would imagine this would be a good opportunity to send a message to government in terms of what would you want government to do to be able to create a proper operating environment for you to make sure that more and more farmers, because I know you've done it with sorghum, you've done it with cassava, and maybe we have a lot of matoke in my village that goes to waste. Who knows what's going to be the next alcohol that comes, from UBL. So what message would you like to send to government? Thank you.
Thank you, Cham. I think I'll direct that one to really the man who is in that current situation and chasing that agenda. You know yourself, Mr. Mbogwa. Please give us a few words in that space.
All right. Thank you. Thank you, Cham. It's good to note that Eunice is doing her job and our suppliers are getting paid in time and in full. And we have seen you thrive, which is very clear. So, very good question. And if you step back through, I think one of the questions that was fielded by Jimmy at the start, around strategic partnerships. We realized, I think, and as we've continued to engage and work with government, that
bringing our partners along, not just going in to, you know, engage on particular exercise positions, what would work vis-a-vis World Bank reports, etc., but being able to then partner with people like NARU, OWC, the various aggregators across the country, be able to profile the story of the farmers. And you can see the way we've done this year's roadshow, coming all the way back from February, March. It has been about partnerships in the agricultural sector that will drive transformation. Once that becomes the backbone of the narrative of what you're telling, then piecing that together with an optimal exercise regime just becomes the icing on the top. So you can see that the strategy is very clear. It is first have the right partners in the bus, have the right actors in the bus to create that broad-based change, and then present your agenda to the government of the day. And I think that way, it will be a much more sustainable effort in terms of how we transform and have an enabling environment for local sourcing.
Maybe I could also add on, Cham. I think the other key thing for us is not only getting government partners, but also getting people like you who are influencers in society, the media, to write about these good stories. Because there's a very, very good story around cassava and sorghum, and as you rightly said, for the first time, those subsistence farmers are commercializing agriculture. How do we continue playing that agenda so that everybody hears, so that it's around music, even for government, that you can help people to commercialize agriculture through the use of things like cassava, bananas, which don't even require a lot of inputs, like tea or tobacco.
Thank you very much, Jimmy. Gentleman in... Yes. I think the microphone is just behind you. Thanks.
I appreciate and also wonder how Nell Breweries have been so consistent in terms of the production supply. I mean, Uganda Breweries, I know what I drink, I don't know the difference between the two. Yeah, in terms of supply, there's not enough sorghum, there's not enough other byproducts. You find that they're not enough in the country. I'm wondering how you're able to consistently supply to the market, despite the fact that there are not so many of that. And then also through the climbing ladder of COVID-19, it has been tough. Money business have come down. And of course, I think drinking bars were closed and all that. So I'm wondering, how have you been able to be on the map all this time? Thank you.
Okay, I hear two questions there. So the first one, I'll direct it to Mark, and I'll repeat it for Mark's sake, which is around how are we managing our sourcing of sorghum and barley and our raw materials against, scarcity. So it's that fine balance between, food crop and cash crop. Time-old, conversation that we've been having. How do we balance the sourcing and also the food security of the nation? That's for you, Mark. The second one is around how we're operating in this tough environment, if I heard you correctly. With the bars being closed for close to 2 years now, how are we maintaining and trading? And even, if it's something that Jimmy mentioned, we're one of the few companies that managed to maintain and sustain our staff. We haven't laid off anybody. We've kept our staff healthy and safe. So what are we doing different, perhaps, than other organizations? And I think that one I'll direct it to our group CEO, and she can give us a bird's eye view actually of East Africa rather than answering just for Uganda. So what have we done as East African breweries to emerge stronger out of this tumultuous time? So I'll start with Mark, over to you. Mark, you're muted, I believe.
Can you hear me?
Now
hello.
I can hear you.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Juliana, can you hear me?
Yes, we can hear you, Mark.
Okay, thanks for the question, and thank you to the person that's asked the question. It is indeed a big challenge and something that's interesting to balance out, but which is why not only in Uganda breweries, but also across East African breweries, in Kenya and in Tanzania as well. We actually do work proactively with the farmers that we engage. So we provide seed, we provide technical know-how, we provide fertilizer. In some cases, we also provide linkage to financial institutions for them to be able to get credit to expand their businesses. So in this kind of partnership, we're able to increase their yields through the quality of the yield, but also through acreage because they're able to get credit. And because of that, in a way, we're able to balance out the need for them to exist subsistently, so some of the food that they plant, they eat, but also commercially in the sense that we're able to provide market for the grain that they produce. Now, just because we have a partnership with them does not mean that we lock them up to selling to us, but they're actually free to go out into the market, which means that the prices that we offer them for their produce are actually market prices. So it's a bit of a chicken and egg thing, but because of the way that we build the partnership, I think it's able to exist and to grow and to develop.
Thank you very much, Mark. Over to you, Jane.
Thank you, Juliana. And thank you for the question. I think we know through COVID it's been tough. I think nobody expected the level of disruption that has come our way with the restrictions, tough trading environment, consumers, their income is depressed. So it is a big challenge. But what we decided as a business is to keep listening to what is going on. And I think Alvin and even Mark talked about how are the channels changing? How are they shifting? How is the consumer changing? Where are they buying? What are they buying? And how are they consuming their favorite brands? And once we understood that and continue to understand that, then internally, we became very agile. So, and I want to thank our staff across East Africa. We saw some passion and some agility and speed to act like we've never seen before. So they were following wherever the consumer was going. And I think that has helped us defray some of the challenges of COVID-19. Are we where we would have been if there was no COVID-19? Absolutely not. So we are hoping that we can deal with this tragedy called COVID-19 and then get back our business on track. But it remains a challenge. But however, internally, we are trying to do what we can to ensure that you are celebrating responsibly and safely as when you're out there. And when you're our own employee trying to deliver the brands for you, you're also doing it safely. So to summarize, I think listening to what is going on in the dynamic environment, having a very agile culture, very fast-paced, always listening in to the consumer being key, as always, and then just saying that you want to go for every opportunity that is out there. So you know you'll not be 100%, but if an opportunity comes, we need to grab it. I hope I've answered your question, but it's still tough. It's still very tough.
Thank you very much, Jane. Yes, no, you've absolutely exhausted it. And I think it was Mark who said earlier, innovate or die, adapt or die. Mm-hmm. And that's kind of the stance that we have taken at Uganda Breweries. I have space or room for two more. The mic. Oh, go ahead, sir.
Thank you very much. My name is Joshua. I would like to thank the panelists as they all submitted. I was really, really enriched. I felt I benefited much more than anyone else in this room. I don't know about you people. but also, it left me with a lot of questions at the back of my mind. I was wondering, how many Ugandans, young Ugandans, has each one of you touched by mentoring and grooming? And probably it takes me to the next question. What is the brewery's mentorship program like? And what does it take for young Ugandans out there to get attached to any of most of you so that we have people who live ambassadors in this market forever and ever? Thank you very much.
Thank you, the young gentleman who's looking for inspiration. I think I'll direct that question to my own personal friend and mentor, Marian Muyobo. I think she's mentored many of us. And you know, her own journey, she spoke a little bit about it and how she entered the brewery. Myself, I'm a testament to how young people can enter what we're calling, you know, the UBO fraternity. I am a management trainee. So Marion interviewed me, and please don't mention anything that happened that day. But yes, over to you, Marion.
Thank you very much. I think I need to try and sit one day and count, because it's not very easy. If I take every single person who has been through me in all the places that I've worked, whether it's at Uganda Breweries or where I currently work, there are a lot of people that I mentor. There are a lot of groups that I have also joined where we are undertaking a lot of mentorship. Juliana, I think you're blocking. Yeah, so there are a lot of groups that I have joined where we're doing a lot of mentorship programs. And many of these are online. Many of them these days also are on social media, where you can actually do, you know, like large group mentorship programs, as well as, I mean, as I say, where I work right now at Total ENP, we have a dedicated team of mentors who are attached to mentees within the company. So how can you yourself get to be mentored by any one of us? I guess it's a conversation that has to also happen. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Marion. And yes, as I alluded to, every year we take in a group of about 6-7 young, promising adults fresh out of the university. And a lot of them are sitting in this room. Supply chain director was one of them. He's also a management trainee. There's a couple of others. So the opportunities are rife. I think for you, it's just a personal, you have to make the personal step forward to answer the youth out there and online. You just need to make that bold move. Okay, one last question, and then we have to get off the air. I believe there's a gentleman here. Thank you.
About COVID-19 during this pandemic, borders were closed. There are so many travel restrictions. And I was wondering 15 years ago, if Uganda Breweries had not to expand their market share by 30%. Now, what is your advice to other manufacturers vis-a-vis local industries in this country, the importance of investing in local
import substitution and our agenda over the last few decades in this space. So Alvin, over to you on that topic.
Thank you. I didn't get his name. I think to the...
My name is Brian.
Okay, pleasure, Brian. And thank you very much for the question. You've had all the leaders today, and I think at the first part of today's session, we use different phrases, strategic partnerships, ESG, SDG goals, but create win-win environments. It's not about UBL and no one else does. UBL will not see the next day. But if you
and you will continue to be a greater actor and contributor in to our fellow industry players. Thank you.
If you want to go fast, you go alone. If you want to go further, you go together. Thank you very much. So I will allow our host and waves. It's been an awesome 2.5 hours. I encourage everybody of our 75th anniversary celebrations with us. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Juliana. And again, members of the press, the different stakeholders who are in the room today, and the people who are watching us on YouTube, social media, NTV, we want to thank you very much for listening to us. I'd like to take this opportunity to personally thank NTV, especially Johnson Omolo, the MD, for the support they have given us in pulling this together. I'd like to thank NBS, who are also in the room, and all the other TV stations who've managed to broadcast us live. Let me also take the opportunity to thank our staff, led by Juliana, Doreen, and the rest of the team, David, Eunice, all the people who are in the room here today. Thank you very, very much for pulling this together. You are such a great team, and it is always a pleasure to work with people like you, because you do understand what marketing a great brand is all about. Finally, let me say thank you to the panel. Thank you, Jen, our group MD, for flying all the way, sharing us your words of wisdom, your trailblazer, as we said, and continue doing the good work.
Thank you.
Alvin, thank you very much. As I always say, you just keep rising and keep doing that, and we do wish you well. Marion, thanks for taking time. Thank you for sharing with us some of those lovely days of marketing. And we do hope that you also have success in your journey. Mark, joining us all the way from Dar, thank you. Thank you very much for the words of wisdom around sustainability, around the history of the brewery, and above all, for some of the innovations that you think we need to be doing. So ladies and gentlemen, it's a shame we're not able to be joined by Baker Magunda, but he's currently in this post, and we wish him well. But thank you, and let's go safe, and let's continue celebrating life every day, everywhere. Thank you.